You are listening to Voices from the Diaspora.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Voices from the Diaspora. Our show today is a three-part show with two very interesting and insightful interviews, followed by a panel discussion on the state of the healthcare sector of Sierra Leone led by Mr. Madiyu Savage. Our first interview is done by a new member of the Voices from the Diaspora team and international award-winning journalist Ms. Claudia Anthony, who talks to Sierra Leone's newly appointed Minister of Transport and Aviation, Mr. Leonard Balogun Kuroma, who maps out his vision for the transport and aviation industries in the country. She first asked him to reveal the immediate challenges he was confronted with when he took over the ministry. Here's the interview.
Even before I assumed the office of Minister of Transport and Aviation, there are certain observations that I had made, not having the slightest idea that he would one day head the ministry and be in a situation wherein I would have to tackle them head on. For example, at Fordham College, I didn't like the long lines that I was seeing at Fordham College, with students struggling to build at Momama in the east of Cape Town. What's the rationale behind this construction? And tell us, where did it come from?
Well, yes, I'm sure that Tony, you traveled several times from London, and it takes you about 6 hours of flight, and it might take you another 6 hours to come across the river to your final destination on your own. I mean, this is not an incentive for foreign investors or foreign businesses who want to come and invest in this country. Some big-time investors want to come in the morning, have a business center at the airport, have a conference center at the airport, conduct all their businesses, and go back in the evening without necessarily coming into the city if they don't have to do so. This is what is happening in an advanced country. And that is the vision of His Excellency, the President, that we should have a modern airport with modern runways. He said the runways at Lungye, we are upgraded. Of oil going on in the scientist in the meteorological department, if you're trying to convert from the department to an agency, challenges in Sierra Leone maritime administration with the register of ships, foreign vessels, and safety.
So interesting in cases where we understand some from the competition in the airports where it's like foreign vessels.
Yes, indeed. I worked at the Ministry of Agriculture, Natural Resources and Fisheries, and I'm familiar with problems of this type of foreign vessels tearing their nets in terms of fishermen and hitting their boats in the high seas. And these are all problems that we have to follow, that we have to monitor, and the Maritime Administration is doing the part in addressing those problems. Of course, the problems at the Sierra Leone Port Authority as well. Delays in the clearing of containers, the problem of middlemen at the Old Farm College building. This is bad news for the diaspora because a lot of them try to get like aid and all the charity to send to Sierra Leone, and the things get stuck down at the quay. Well, one of their own is now the Minister of Transport and Aviation. And once this problem is brought to my notice, I will see how best we can do collectively to address that.
You are heading in the political corridors of the office of the Vice President during the first term of President Hamid Karzai's administration. Under what circumstances did you step back?
The President is not obligated to explain the circumstances of his appointment or sacking to anybody. The Constitution says it is his prerogative. It is his prerogative. And after my sacking, extensive inquiries were made. And the Minister of Information and Communication at the time, I like people in Kabu, I could remember, was interviewed on the BBC, and he was asked specifically the reason for my sacking at the time, if we could proceed that way. And the Minister said, it is the President's prerogative. And he was further asked, is it connected with any criminal activity? And the Minister replied, a categorical no. And after that, the President appointed me as coordinator for the 50th Independence Anniversary Celebrations of Sierra Leone, which you can understand was very successful.
Except that this committee did not mention the only ceremonial President of Sierra Leone, Sirico.
Yes, that is unfortunate. I took over 8 weeks to the celebrations. At the time I took over, the committee was riddled with problems, as you all are aware, and I was brought in by the President to solve the situation. And I did that, I made it turn around in 8 weeks. And after the 50th anniversary, the President appointed me again as National Coordinator for the 2012 elections, presidential, parliamentary, and local councils, and I again delivered with flying colors. And now, here I am, the Minister of Transport and Aviation of Sierra Leone.
Thank you very much, Olugun Kuruma, Minister of Transport and Aviation.
Thank you very much. You're very welcome.
That was Sierra Leone's Minister of Transport and Aviation, Mr. Leonard Balogun Kuruma, ending that interview with Freetown-based international award-winning journalist Ms. Claudia Anthony.
And I shall be interviewing John Bembas to say the press attaché to China. the first leadership from Sierra Leone to China. Hello, John. Could you say hello to our listeners, please?
Yeah, good evening, good morning, because it's now in the morning, now we're in China.
Okay, thank you very much, and first of all, I'd like to welcome you to Voices from the Diaspora, and thank you for taking the time to do this interview for us. So you are the press attaché. Diplomatic relationships are very important, especially as we are keen to see Sierra Leone in a positive light. For the benefit of our listeners, what does your job entail?
Well, my job generally, when you look at the role of a journalist, most often I've said that it's like transmitting, you know, activities of the embassy to the general public. But when you look at it from a diplomatic front, you know, we've got a lot in terms of what it entails. But it's all have to do with my very self serving as a spokesperson for the Sierra Leone mission, you know, in the People's Republic of China, with accreditation to several other countries in Southeast Asia, you know. And over the years, I think we've been doing our best to ensure we keep our people abreast in terms of development or happenings in the mission, and also looking at what is happening back home. So that is what I've been doing over the years, and this is my job.
Okay, thank you very much for that, for making that clear. So what is your communication strategy to make sure that the public is kept well informed in a timely way about our relationship with China and other Southeast Asia countries?
Oh, yes, there is something like a competition strategy, because if you are to succeed as communications expert in a given institution or as the press officer in any institution, you must have a strategy in terms of how you want to run your activities or how you want to ensure your mission or your organization you're working for is brought to the public. Because generally, when you look at what it is like, you're trying your best to keep the institution or the embassy you're working for to the general public. And over the years, what we've been doing is we have a lot of components when you look at the strategy itself, primarily when you look at the medium we're using to reach the general public. Of course, we've been using the radio stations just as we are interviewing now. You know, we're using the newspapers, you know, we report on activities happening in the mission, we grant radio interviews. We use also social media. In fact, last week I was talking with His Excellency the President, and that was one thing he asked. He was asking how is what is happening in social media, and I was very much impressed. You know, when he asked that question, which means he's also concerned and he wants to know what is happening. And that's really been over the years. There is a strategy, and the strategy itself we've been using. We've been looking at some of the main streams we communicate to the public, and try to get an impact and then see how...
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And I'll just go on to the next part of the discussion. China appears to have a lot of interest in Sierra Leone and has helped a lot over the years with building infrastructure. How important is the relationship with China as we look forward to the future of Sierra Leone in terms of becoming a developed country?
Well, let me start off by telling you that the diplomatic relations between the two countries, I mean Sierra Leone and China, started as well in the 1970s. You know, and then since then, I think the Sino-Sierra Leone relation have been moving up tremendously. And talking about the importance, you know, since the establishment of short-term relations about four decades or so ago, we've seen how a country like China has continued to support the infrastructure development of developing countries, to which Sierra Leone is no exception, you know. And besides, I think there is always a win-win situation we're talking about. That's why I also refer to Sierra Leone also did for China, you know, when China was like trying to enter into the United Nations General Assembly in the 70s. Sierra Leone did a very crucial role, you know, in terms of all supporting them, you know, and then ensuring that they go to the UN, they go to different countries as a matter of fact. So the contrast is so great to the extent that if you look at the infrastructure development of Sierra Leone, they've done a lot in supporting us in terms of constructing roads, bridges, you know, national system, as you know, and a lot of other infrastructure development. And since then, what you specifically they want to look at, which has been happening since the establishment of FOCAC, you know, in early 2000. And since the development of the framework took a different dimension in terms of, because when you look at the development operation, they've always talked about results orientation and the winning operation. And over the years, these things have been happening. We've seen a lot of results, and they've not paid much premium in terms of conditionality. And we continue to make progress with this team. That only 2 months ago or so, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the Chinese Energy Group, Energy Group, which went into an MOU with the Sierra Leone government, and they're going to invest something like $60 billion into Sierra Leone's infrastructure development. So, over the years, the last 4 years or so, we've got a lot, achieved a lot. The relationship keeps going. And also, last year, the president himself did see that he's very much impressed that the final Sierra Leone relation has taken a different dimension today.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. I'm sure our listeners would appreciate that. One of the major concerns that people have with the system from China, that it is used, that we could, Sierra Leone could also be used as a tablet to sell their own unemployment issues. It is used that a lot of their labor is imported, and when they help build infrastructure, they don't use local labor, and that doesn't help our economy in ways that it could. Especially, we would have GM infrastructure, but in terms of employment, they bring everything. And so there's a lot of concern about that. There's also some concern about the increased rate of Chinese prostitutes in Sierra Leone. And what do you say to these concerns?
Well, I think you're right. You're talking about the concerns of people generally, you know, when you also look at the China-Africa relations. If we know there are challenges, we know as a country that we can't get 100% society or situation when you look at the relationship between the two countries. But the China have often been the attempt to ask people to look at the results or to look at the impact you've been getting over the years, you know, since the establishment of bilateral relations between the two countries. And a country that tends to develop sort of rationing infrastructural effort. And I think China keeps playing a critical role in that direction. I'm not saying that everything is happening. There are also some challenges. You know, the expectations of Sierra Leoneans are too big, and if you have to address it all, within a period of 5-10 years, if you are a president, you won't be able to even look half of that. So that is why when you come, you have your goals, you have your agenda. And now let me refer you to the change of agenda that the president used to govern Sierra Leone in the last 5 years. We realize that there are key components, among them infrastructure, energy production, and we see what has been happening or what has been coming from China. So you should look at the development cooperation framework. I refer to the win-win cooperation. You know, they don't get much premium about issues of issues as compared to traditional business. You know, and for us, we want to develop, we want to move along with the international trend. We want to see how we can also put our path behind us, because we know for education, so we went through a civil war, and we destroyed our infrastructure, we destroyed our economy, and we try to rebuild our country. And if we have a country that is ready to give us what we need, you know, the Chinese is going to give you, $1 million. They will give you $1 million. And a lot of that, a good chunk of that money, will be used into the purpose for which it is given. And I think we should look at positive results we can get at the end of each cooperation or each agreement we get. I'm not saying other countries are not doing it. Well, other countries in the sense are traditional donors, they are also doing extremely well. Because for us, from the perspective of our relationship with China, is the establishment of diplomatic relations in the community, today, much has been happening and much will continue to happen.
Okay, thank you very much. Whilst I'm talking about China and our relationship with them, you mentioned in the past ways in which Sierra Leone has contributed to China and that it's very much a partnership kind of relationship. In the present day, with them helping us with a number of things, what contribution do we give to them as a nation in return?
The contribution we make to them as in return as a country, you mean? Is that what you right?
Yeah. So diplomatic relationships are normally mutually beneficial to both, and we are getting a lot, but it may not be very clear what we are doing now in return with our relationship with China. So in the past, like you mentioned, we were significant in supporting them to getting into the UN and stuff like that. Move on to the present day, where they continue to do to assist us in a number of things. How are we giving back?
Yes, I may have not got your question. Well, I think you're looking at, you know, we're coming to the airport, and you're looking at the contribution we're making to China, you know, from the perspective of them supporting us. And that is the case. And let me tell you that I made reference to what we did in the 70s, you know, when China, the People's Republic of China, was trying to go into the United Nations General Assembly. Small as we are at the time, the position of most of other countries as well, African countries, you know, we supported the People's Republic of China. We never knew China was going to cease to be, right, Ali. But we gave them the support they needed at the time through the foreign minister, you know, essentially part, and then we got the impact we needed. And today, China is making a lot of impact when it comes to international trend from the perspective of international politics, international economy, and international diplomacy. And we still continue supporting them. Now, in terms of happening at the international arena, you know, there are times issues may come up, for instance, at the United Nations General Assembly. And you can say this in a certain country to support you if you are in need of something. You're small as we are as a nation, but also proud of the fact that we have a contribution role to international peace and then international development. We've always stood by China in whatever thing they're moving towards, you know, in terms of them advocating for an issue. Because we know they support us, and we're also supporting them. You know, there are a lot of Chinese companies operating in our country. And as an embassy, for instance, or as a country, we can support them. Those companies that are representing the Chinese interest, and as a matter of fact, all of them are representing the interest of China. And we've got the responsibility to support them. And we have been doing that for many years.
Okay.
And there are nominations coming up, for the United Nations, you know, for Chinese nationals, and then they need to support for Sierra Leone. And we're coming and giving them. We have been coming in, giving them such support because we know they are supporting our infrastructure development, so they are supporting in building human infrastructure of Sierra Leone. Last year, we received 28 students from Sierra Leone who came to China to pursue different courses in academia. And this year, they are really telling us we're going to receive. We're going to receive some Sierra Leoneans again. So, you know, more Sierra Leoneans. So that is encouraging. We know we haven't got the capacity to reciprocate in terms of what they're doing or to give the team. But the little way we give it, the little way we can, because of supporting them, we have been doing it, and we will continue to do that. And even, for instance, when is the excellent ambassador to support our influence in the office of discrimination, to the Department of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, He made it abundantly clear that he's ready to support China's interest in whatever direction, you know. And then we've also been supporting the World China policy, and I think this is great, you know, and we'll continue to do that because international diplomacy entails a lot, international politics entails a lot. Looking at what China is offering us, I think it is not necessary we keep supporting them in whatever little way we can.
Thank you. Thank you for explaining that. I'm sure our listeners appreciate that. As you mentioned again, internationally, diplomacy is very important. And in your role as a public official, you're bound to face criticisms from within Sierra Leone and possibly maybe even outside. How do you handle conflicts, especially in conflicts within Sierra Leone, among Sierra Leoneans, who may criticize you in such a way that it does not impact negatively on our country as a diplomatic partner?
Sorry, can conflicts from each country, from within the activities of our nationals in China, you mean?
No, in general, you're a public official and you interact with the media, you interact with Sierra Leone on various platforms of various media, and you are bound to get criticisms from Sierra Leone and on various platforms. Say, for instance, social media, you could be criticised. And my question is, how do you handle conflicts in such a way that you do not, that you continue to portray Sierra Leone in a good way?
Okay, you may be looking at my constitution from the framework of social media. I think, you know, as I said, we're driving towards the airport, and you want to know how we land in that from the framework of avoiding conflicts, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me start off by saying that as an embassy, we have a responsibility to not only serve as representatives of our country here, but to also see how best we can negotiate some issues, you know, on behalf of our country. And for me, as the press and information attaché, you know, as a perspective for the embassy, I've got a lot. You ask at the onset of the interview, there are even strategy in terms of keeping our responsibilities, which specifically refers to minorities, I told you guys. And then, with all the impact social media has been creating over the years, look at what has been happening around the world, look at what happened in the Arab world, the Arab Spring we've been referring to, that's how social media is helping to change issues. And I think for us as an embassy, if we want to reach our Sierra Leoneans across the world, and specifically in China, there is a need for us to use social media. And I think we've been doing that for the years. Now, I know the perspective from which you're coming. We've been doing our best. I've been doing our best to ensure that we present what is happening from the embassy, and try to separate such from my own opinion in terms of developing back home. And we'll continue to do that. But today, let me ask you to inform you or to state here that you never are expected to be society. There must be challenges. But these are challenges we overcome. Even when you look at this within, we have a lot of challenges. You know, being able to reach each and every Sierra Leonean in China or across Asia, all the countries they are accredited to. Also, increasing our best. That is why we have channels of communication. We have a Sierra Leonean community here. We have a chairman. We have groups of people. And then we've been reaching them. And we now see Chinese married in Africa, and these are things we continue to bring up to the Sierra Leonean public. You know, we continue to engage them. You know, as I said, you want to expect the best from me. I've been doing my best to give my best to Jim. You know, but I will not be able to reach or to meet the expectation of each and every Sierra Leonean. I think I've always said it is the responsibility of Sierra Leoneans to ensure the quality of Sierra Leone lives up to expectation and performs as expected. In a sense, we need to give our support to the embassy, and not just the embassy, you know, in China, but embassies across the world, Sierra Leonean embassies, and in giving our support to government. because we want to do our best to meet your expectation. But if you don't give us the support we need from you guys, it's going to be a problem. So we'll be utilizing the media, you know, we wish them, and we continue to do that. And I think we have a responsibility to perform, and we'll perform. And the intention of the success of the new ambassador is to see how he takes the embassy to Sierra Leone, and he brings Sierra Leoneans to the embassy, literally, I mean. And these are things we are going to meet. You know, so I work with the Sierra Leonean community in China, irrespective of one's political, belonging, tribe, or religion. We all know that when we are in China, we are Sierra Leoneans, and that is what we've been working towards. And we keep talking with them, Tabi. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for that. At the moment, you know, you're in China as the press attaché, and presently we have a mission going to China, which includes the president, and there's also communication people in his entourage. And how do you interact with the general communication people that may be in
interaction has been good. If you look, if you look at the update that has been coming from China in the last 1 week, you realize that the Sierra Leone embassy is collaborating with the office of the president. I mean, specifically the communications unit of the office of the president. Because now the communications unit is covering the activities of the president, right?
Yeah.
The press office in the Sierra Leone embassy is covering activities of the Sierra Leone mission in China. To several other countries. Now, if the president arrives in China, it is very need for us to work as a team. And this is what we've been doing. If you send me updates from China, it comes from Anjara. Because these are the two guys that are covering the mission, right, and the presidency, respectively. And the interaction has been very, very great. And again, Let me rush up to tell you that the thesis of the president has been very fruitful, very successful. Only last night, I had a discussion with him. I'm going to write it up for the general public, and it's talking about the outcome, you know.
Okay.
He was so impressed, and he said, imagine this, you know, the Sierra Leone-China relation has been taken to another level. You know,
Thank you.
Meetings with state officials. I met with the Chinese president. He has not started him out with the vice president of China. He presented a statement at Tsinghua University, as the leading university in China. You know, he presented a paper on security from the perspective of international trade, you know, development and progress of it. You know, that tells you Sierra Leone is fine. Sierra Leone is making mark, and we should be proud of our country as Sierra Leone, as irrespective of what it can belong to. So we have a lot of, Hainan province and all the rest, you know, to see how we continue collaborating in terms of supporting our agricultural development, our desires, energy, and a lot of other areas. So this is what's fruitful. We got some positive results, and I think the Sino-Sierra Leone relation, as mentioned by the excellency said last night, has taken a different dimension.
Oh, thank you very much for that. Because my next question was going to be how successful has this trip that the president has made to the people of China been so far?
Yes.
And you have assured that it has been.
It was very successful. You know, it was very successful. If you keep following social media, people have been asking about the delegation, the number of people who came. You know, if you come in to discuss the investment opportunities, he's coming to see how we get more support from a country like China. There is nothing for you to come with government ministers. You know, let me inform you. Let me inform the world through your medium now that 70% or so of the cost, you know, was handled by the Chinese side. because we've observed there are a lot of comments coming from social media. These are the impact that we're going to get at the end of the day. Now, both millions of Remedy went to Sierra Leone, you know, are supported from the Chinese government, and these are resources we're going to use for the coming years. Like it was very fruitful, it was good that we had key members of government, you know, being part of the delegation, and as I think they're moving out to Mongolia to see how we continue with the defeat. Let me just use this opportunity again to say thank you so much for talking to us as an embassy, and thank you for taking this training mission to the Slovenians, to the public, and especially to the Slovenians, and we'll continue talking to you. Please give us your support. Feel free to reach us. If there is an issue you want clarification from the embassy, we are always ready to talk to you. It is our policy of the mission. So, open up. You know, public communication is very important in present the government, and we continue to utilize that. Thank you so much, Kadi.
Okay, you're very welcome. And finally, before you go and invite our listeners, I would like, can you assure our listeners that you, Press Attaché, and Jara, you have mentioned, will keep us informed, as you already have, continuously with the updates on how this whole mission and trip is going. Can you give us an assurance?
That is what is happening. That is what will continue to happen. If you did not see updates from me in terms of what the president said yesterday, I mean, that is because we know there is a need for my social media and Jara around. You know, Jara can represent us. He brings out the issue that we are discussing. And we keep out to the public. You know, collaboration is very important to me.
It is, indeed.
Yeah, the subject of your region is because you are collaborating, working as a team. And then we've seen this over the years, you know, that is why, let me discuss politics now, that is why we are able to win the elections, because President Kuma works with everybody in his team to ensure he was voted. And then he is officer, you know, which means if you collaborate, you cooperate with other people, you get the results you need. I will continue to do that. And if President Kuma is to travel to Senegal, Jara can also come to work with the press office, Australian embassy. There is no need to bring different stories from the same angle, no. And then, I mean, we are very much aware of our responsibility as people who are part of the communication unit of the president. When they come here, we know they are covering the activities of the president, and I'm here covering the activities of the Slovenian mission. It is only when we work, you know, as a team that we get the results we need. And that's the results we got in the last couple of days. And then we continue working as a team to update you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and we Voices from the Diaspora will be listening to you, to hear from you and Jara Kosukonte about your trip and everything that's happening and all the positive things that you are doing. We definitely look forward to it, and we'll be holding you to that.
Welcome yet to another edition of Voices from the Diaspora Radio Discussion Program. In today's panel discussion, we will explore the topic, the healthcare system in contemporary Sierra Leone. It is common knowledge that the health statistics in our country have been pretty awful in almost every department of the health sector. These, in turn, have played a key role in ensuring Sierra Leone's plight to the bottom half of the Human Development Index. The picture is changing, though, and it is beginning to change, thanks to the introduction of the free health care scheme. But the country has to improve in terms of preparedness for any epidemic, such as the one we witnessed last year. We still recall the cholera epidemic, that cholera epidemic as a black box of desolation, devastation, and death. We hope it is not a paradigm for what is to come in the future. To discuss today's topic, I have a panel of fine minds in the presence of Dr. Fide Dafe, Mr. Charles Mambu, and Mr. Hussein Ibrahim. Dr. Fide Dafe is the manager in charge of the National Disease Surveillance and Response Team in the Ministry of Health and Sanitation. Mr. Charles Mambu is a civil society and human rights activist. He is an economist by training. He joined activism in 1996 and contributed to the country's return to democratic rule. Currently, he is the executive director of the Health for All Coalition in Sierra Leone. This network is present in all 149 kingdoms and 52 wards in the western area. It advocates improved health care service delivery to the poor and effectively monitoring and contributes to effective monitoring and report on the implementation of the health care scheme. Mr. Hussein Ibrahim has had 15 years' experience running and administering a health organization in several countries, including Sri Lanka, Iraq, South Sudan, Jordan, Syria, Gaza, and in Sierra Leone. He was involved in the construction and rehabilitation of two primary health care centers in the north and east of Sierra Leone. Now, we'll go straight to the topic. Dr. Duffy, can you just say hello to our audience?
Yeah, good evening, Duffy.
Yes. Mr. Mambu?
Hello to listeners.
And Mr. Ibrahim?
Good evening, listeners.
Let's go straight to the first question. Like I said, just never looking at the healthcare system generally. Dr. Duffy, the free healthcare scheme was launched in April 2010. What is your assessment of the scheme 3 years on?
Well, as we know, when we talk about anything that has been introduced, there are mostly some hidden problems. However, having said that, I must say that free healthcare is working, is going on as we would have expected. That is, we are not saying that we'll be able to solve all the problems at one go, but things are moving on well, and we hope that Sierra Leone would be very high up there.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Mr. Mambu, do you want to say anything regarding what Mr. Duffy has said? Because you've been monitoring what the people have been doing, yes.
Yeah, thank you very much. Before monitoring the free healthcare, my organization was involved in advocacy for the introduction of the free healthcare by 2009. This came about as a result of our then very, very poor health indicators. Mind you, we were having the highest infant mortality and maternal death in the world, you know, which means Sierra Leone was the most risky country where women, we are to give back to children. So as a result of that, my organization, you know, brought together a lot of civil society for us to look at our role in reducing the infant mortality and maternal death. And we launched a campaign which we call Abolition of User Fee, which directly was meant for the introduction of the free health care. Upon the introduction of the free health care on the 27th of April 2012 and 10, my organization continues to monitor the implementation of the initiative. And we also continue to conduct a lot of community education into the understanding of the concept of the free health care and to ensure that service delivery is actually taken to the area where they are most needed. I will say, without share of favor, that my organization, Health Coalition in Sierra Leone, is involved in all aspects relating to the implementation of quality healthcare service delivery in the country, which is done through advocacy, monitoring, and community education. 2 years down the lane, during the implementation of the free healthcare, one bit of achievement it has called, we have had the highest political will, we have had the highest attention on the health sector by both development partners, including and more especially the Department for International Development, which is the British Development Wing, known as DFI, UNICEF, UNFPA, World Bank, and a lot of other international organizations are currently contributing to support the health sector. We have the political will from the presidential level up to the ministerial and to civil society, which is headed by Health for All Coalition. We have had massive distribution. As I'm talking to you, we are doing the second quarter distribution of the free healthcare drugs being procured, funded by DFI through British support to Sierra Leone, the government of Sierra Leone, and the government of Sierra Leone as well. So massive drugs and medical facilities are being procured and supplied to the community, which is meant to reduce the infant mortality and maternal death. Government is actually paying a lot of efforts in supporting the health sector. However, like Dr. Gaffey said, it goes without saying that there are also major challenges in the area of the change of attitude from the health worker. From the report we have, some health workers still continue to charge the beneficiaries of the fair care, which includes and limited to pregnant women, lactating women and children under the age of 5 years. Some health workers still continue to charge fees for these people or their medical services. In some communities, we have recorded not only support of drugs as a result of theft, but we have also recorded community non-participation in the implementation of the free healthcare. These are some of the challenges that have been associated with the free healthcare, and on a weekly, monthly, and quarterly basis, Network Coalition brings out a state report on the implementation of the initiative.
Yeah. It's very brilliant contribution by Dr. Jaffi and Mr. Mambu. Mr. Ibrahim, would you like to make a contribution in that regard?
Yes, I want to thank the last caller for what he said. Very educative and informative. But however, what I see is we are still focusing on infrastructure and policy and curative side of it. Now, we need to define health. What is health? I mean, if we can feel where health is the well-being of an individual, then we need to consider not only the physical aspects, but both the mental, social, and environmental aspects of it. Let's take a typical case. A patient goes to a doctor. He gets registered at the reception, sits at the waiting room until he gets called into the doctor. the doctor does is the diagnosis, and for example, diagnosed malaria and give medication, patient goes out. What is wrong with that picture? What I see wrong with that picture is preventive or health education is not passed on. The circumstances of the patient, the social, the environmental, and also teaching that patient how to prevent getting the malaria. I think it's one of the things that is lacking, or we are lacking. I mean, good health is the fundamental well-being of life itself. I mean, it's after all the processes. We have to think of various aspects of it, from malnutrition, elimination of malnutrition, to ignorance, contaminated drinking water, and unhygienic housing. I mean, I know a lot is being done. Hospitals have been built, drugs have been distributed. But we've seen the emphasis is more intuitive rather than preventive.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Baby. You made a very brilliant contribution there, making the distinction, the dichotomy between preventive medicine and curative medicine. Of course, the debate is always out there. I mean, it's an academic debate whether the present model of healthcare we have in the country, you know, is sustainable and whether it is the most ideal, or whether we need to make a shift. There is need for a paradigm shift, for a new model. It is on. But for now, we'll just see if we can go over, look at some of the issues again. Mr. Mambu, you did talk about, I know your organization is doing well on the ground, you know, trying to monitor what is happening in the program. But two crucial issues, really, relating to your work here. I just want to touch on two issues. Drug diversion, because you've been talking about, there have been lapses. I'm not saying it is the dominant issue, but there have been lapses wherein drugs have been diverted, and of course you've been, I mean, your organization has been has been monitoring the situation and outspoken about all these issues, you know, and also like the Gavi funds, you know, that we know that has been addressed in the courts, you know. But, I mean, how do you think these two issues are trying to hamper the efforts, you know, in trying to deliver health care to the poor?
Yeah, well, like I said, while efforts have continued to be made by government and development partners to improve the health sector, Sierra Leone health sector is still among the five worst in the whole world. No doubt about it. Because we still rely on, especially those well to do, taking their families, politicians' rights to Ghana, Senegal, Ivory Coast, and for those who are more privileged to other parts of the world for medical treatment. In terms of the drugs distributions and supply, by 2010-2011, when the process is actually started, we recorded a massive, very massive corruption-related issues within the system, because people were not well monitored, people did not understand. Even the community and the beneficiaries, in fact, on the 27th of April 2010, when the Secretary President launched the initiative, some of the beneficiaries misunderstood the concept. In fact, pregnant women like Katie Morden were seen in Freetown and a lot of other cities, moving from one hospital to another, collecting drugs with the pretext that the screen is only meant for the 27th of April 2010. It took my organizations through our various network monitoring team that we set up, which are supporting the government and development partners, a lot of time actually to carry out community educations, house to house, hospitals, to educate people to understand that the screen is not an event. it's a protest and it's continuing for a long time. So by 2010, 2011, when we have a lot of a problem within the distribution processes, as also verified by the independent team sent by DFID and the government of Sierra Leone, that actually reduces to a larger proportion by end of 2011 and 2012 up to date, because first of all, there were administrative changes at the central medical store. As a result of the reports that you are sending and verified by other, supported by other international teams that you have brought into the country, a lot of changes we have done, both by the government and developer partners, stringent measures were put in place. And today, I tell you, we have more sanity in the distributions of drugs and medical supply for the free healthcare beneficiaries across the country than it was 2010 and 2011. Moreover, like I already said, our health sector, having been on the point of improving, however, it's still very, very, very bad. We are still lack of the actual number of doctors and trained medical personnel as by the gold standard. Sierra Leone is almost short of more than 300 to 400 doctors and nurses that cater for approximately 6 million people. It's a very big challenge. This has been reported and we continue to report on this almost on a daily basis in all our meetings, be it free healthcare or the general healthcare steering committee. Government of Sierra Leone development partners, you know, are looking at those reports and making efforts. Two training institutions have been established in the country. We are now training our nurses and lower leaders of the medicals in the country. However, for us as civil society advocates, we want to see more effort, more resources have been used in this direction so as to improve the standard of our health sector as far as of Senegal and Ghana.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mambo. Our program is coming to you from Voices from the Diaspora, and our topic for today is the healthcare system in contemporary Sierra Leone. Now we'll take a very short break, and when we come back, we'll look at the second segment, which is going to deal specifically with the cholera epidemic in Sierra Leone. Okay. You are listening to Voices from the Diaspora, and our topic today is the healthcare system in contemporary Sierra Leone. The second segment is going to look at the cholera epidemic in Sierra Leone. Dr. Dafe, let me start with you. What structures and processes have been put in place to ensure the country is prepared for the next cholera outbreak, do you think?
Well, let's start with the team that has got this thing up.
Okay.
You will recall that the 2012 cholera epidemic was said to be the worst to affect Sierra Leone over the years.
Okay.
Now, because of the experiences that we got from that outbreak, we have been having cholera outbreak. So even before that, we had what we called cholera task force that was in the ministry. Of course, when you have things like this, you always have the problem that when the outbreak occurs, that's when people come in. But the ministry has been going on with the task force. And that task force has continued to proceed. We have also tried as best as possible to train rapid response teams in all the districts we have had. When there is a case of cholera, they will go there and try to make sure that they try to be on top of the situation and try to manage the outbreak before it even goes out of hand. The other thing is that we now have repositioned enough drugs in almost all the areas, especially in hard-to-reach areas. You see that I came to this discussion a little bit because it has been raining heavily in Freetown. That's one trigger that will tell us that if we don't put things in place, we might end up having the epidemic as we had last year. So in terms of trying to make sure that we create the awareness, at the moment, our health education department in the ministry, together with the world partners, are working flat out to make sure that awareness is created in all the parts of the country. One good thing that is happening in this country for now, my brother, is that in every part of the country, you have a radio station. And sometimes you have even more than one radio station in a district. So we are using those radio stations, using them to pass on the message or the presenting aspect, how they could present cholera. Because the problem is that when you talk about cholera, you are talking about not only the health aspect, you also have got the water aspect of it. You have got the environmental aspect of it, and all those things. That's why we are having this thing. We are going all out to make sure that people are educated, know what causes cholera, and how to prevent it.
Yes. Yes, I think you've made a very salient point there. You know, the prevention, I think, is really important, and the environmental situation in the country, sanitation is also very important. And so that brings me to Mr. Hussein. Ibrahim, can you just give us an assessment? Why do you think the country was caught off guard by last year's cholera epidemic? Although Dr. Duffy has given us some indications there. But you have worked with international NGOs, and you've handled epidemics elsewhere in other countries, you know. Why do you think
Well, I mean, as the last speaker, just said, a lot has been done. And when you see the number of incidents this year, which is way, way lower than the number of incidents last year, the same period, yes, a lot has been done. But a lot still needs to be done. I'm happy to hear that preventive measures, health education is part of the process. However, I think stakeholders, he did mention the environment, he did mention water and sanitation. And I think that's very important. I think they need to engage the other stakeholders. And information is going out. My problem with that is there is not much of that information that's going out. Secondly, some of the clinics I have seen or I have been to, leaflets have been given out. These leaflets are either in a local dialect or in English, and we know the high illiteracy rate. if you can't read and write English, I'm not sure how you can read the local dialect either as well. So that's something that maybe has to be looked at and probably engage communities more verbally rather. I'm happy also to hear about early response, because I've always been thinking about first responders. In Sierra Leone, we do not have first responders. The police, the fire force, the military, none of them are first responders. Communities itself, I am not sure if this emergency response team are part of the Ministry of Health or part of the community itself. So I cannot say much, but what I would say, they have to be part of the community itself, these first responders who can be trained and equipped. This would also be part of their disaster management plan. So you have first responders that would respond to situations in specific areas.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ibrahim. Mr. Mambu, what is your assessment of last year's cholera epidemic, and how do you think we are prepared? How do you think the country is prepared for any other outbreak?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Let me also thank Dr. Nafe for talking a bit about the preventive aspects. Like you rightly said, last year cholera outbreak in Sierra Leone was among the worst. In fact, from the record I have with me, I'm talking to you from my national office in Freetown, 299 people died. Those that were actually recorded by the Ministry of Health, WHO, and others across the country. It started in the northern part of the country, in Cameroon, then spread out to Port-Loko and later to the western area in Freetown. But I want us to look at the basic causes of cholera. As an health advocate, I think I've been positioned in a way that I've learned a lot about the causes of common diseases, transmissions, and necessary due to my interactions with medical practitioners locally and internationally. You know, the issue of sanitation. When we first went to the village where the outbreak was reported in the Kambia district, they have no running water. Their source of drinking water was actually a well that was contaminated as a result of a lot of pollution. They do all their cleaning of the body into that water, and it's the same water that they use without purification to drink. And that also led to a lot of the outbreak, which also spread to Port-Loko district and later to Freetown. I will not say that in Freetown it became worse, simply because our sanitary condition in Freetown is extremely very, very worse. And Health for All Coalition have made and continue to report on the poor sanitary conditions of the city, our capital city, but very little attention has been paid to that. But let me hasten to say that by law, the Ministry of Health and Sanitation is taking charge of the sanitation of the city of Freetown. It is also the responsibility of the Freetown City Council, which by extension is also sent out to another company which they call the Freetown Waste Management Company. And from recent events, the contract was also awarded to another company. And there is both companies are drawing daggers on one another. And that makes Freetown very, very tricky. You know, the many houses in Freetown, I must say, those don't have proper collecting facility. Monitoring from these stakeholders, the Freetown City Council and the Ministry or any other company may have awarded a contract is very, very, very poor. You know, if you move into the city like today, and for the last 2-3 days, it's raining very heavily, and you can see cities, you know, scattered across the city, the streets of Freetown, everywhere. You know, these are areas and sources of cholera in the city and in the community. So for us to prevent and address the issue of cholera, it is most important that the government of Sierra Leone
actually sit down with us together to see how and who should be in charge of the sanitary condition of the city of Freetown, in particularly, and by extension to other communities across the country. So our sanitary, as I'm talking, is extremely very poor. There is filth everywhere. The cleaning is extremely very, very poor due to lack of coordination. Of course, when we get on to Freetown City Council and Waste Management, they also talk about resource and non-availability of resources and machines to carry out the work effectively as per their budget and that of the Freetown Waste Management Company. In regard to preparation, it's raining. Headphone Coalition continue to issue our press releases and engagement with the government of Sierra Leone and communities to ensure that for us not to repeat the 2012 crisis of cholera, we also need to intensify our sanitary condition. However, we have not seen much effort in that direction as I am talking to you. So it's extremely very important. Sanitary operation in Africa is not in the hands by law up to the Ministry of Health and Sanitation, but the Freetown City Council and Waste Management, as they are, and both of them are unable to do. But we are yet to see the central government actually taking the bull by the horn by ensuring that Freetown becomes one of the biggest cities in the world or in Africa or the sub-region. Currently, that is a bigger challenge, and we are still government to take the decision on to come out and see how the sanitary conditions of Sierra Leone will be properly managed so that cholera outbreak will be a team of the past.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mambu. Yes, you've made a very important point there. In terms of sanitation, you know, one area that is really lacking is in terms of how the absence of toilets in most places, in most of our surroundings, especially in the provinces, you know. But even in western area, it's a problem.
Yeah, it's more of a different western area than in provinces.
Yes, and I don't see why the government should, all the government needs to do is to make sure there is an act, a legislation, pass a legislation, a law, that before somebody constructs a house, you must construct the toilet, except wherein we know what you're going to construct. The house you're going to construct is a self-contained. If it is not a self-contained house, then the first thing is you have to construct the toilet first before the house. If a house hasn't got a toilet, then, they make sure nobody lives there. If you must construct, legislation to be able to solve this. If every chief government will implement it. But if you don't, there's no legislation. So tell them that in the next 6 months, if you don't do this, if you have a toilet, then it means the government definitely is going to, do something regarding your house. People would... we're going to...
Can I come in?
Wait, yeah. Sorry?
Yes. Go on.
Yeah, we'll just have to take a short break. We're coming back. We're going to round up. We still have time. We're taking a short break now. You've been listening to Voices from the Diaspora, and our topic is the healthcare system in contemporary Sierra Leone. And we're taking the short break. And in the last segment, we're going to look at the concluding remarks and make recommendations and any other issues that we have. Okay. We'll be right back. Hello, you're listening to Voices from the Diaspora, and our topic for today is the healthcare system in contemporary Sierra Leone. And this is our third segment. In the third segment, we're going to ask our speakers to give their concluding remarks and make recommendations and projections. Dr. Dante, would you like to say something that you did not?
Let me just start with the laws that we are not there. In fact, let me say that laws for this sort of having toilets in your house and cleaning of your surroundings, all those are in the public health ordinance. I mean, those things are there. The only thing is that the laws have not been very effectively implemented. The reason being that sometimes, you know, we tend to see things and they forget about what times we are in. If you look at the law, some of the fines, if you take them to court, believe me, they just say the person will have to pay 2 leone. Can you imagine? When you say somebody has got to define is 2 leone for an offense that is so grave that is putting people at risk. That is why the Ministry of Health at this moment is undergoing, is trying very hard to bring in the directorate of environmental health. And with that, we are also trying to make sure all those laws that were there have got back what or they have to be revised. Time for those things have got to be there. But you knew when we grew up in Freetown here, when there were public health officers going from house to house, making sure that the sanitation of the houses and people were keeping on to those things. But what has gone wrong? Why have we gone wrong? Simply because these laws that are there, if you take them to court, the lawyers will look at it and perhaps just find according to what the law books say. So what we are trying to do now is to revise all these things and make sure that people are punished for things that they should do. If you go up country, because it's there that every house, if you are building your house, you have got to have the toilet attached to it. That one was a must. But unfortunately, it's not being implemented as I'm saying now, because people have just looked at it. And you go there, you take people to court, and the court, you just give them minimal fines. So that is one thing that I am saying here, that the Ministry of Health has got to be supportive that this Department of Environmental Health has now been it came from no other person than His Excellency the President, who saw that we needed these things. And talk about because remember that cholera is a waterborne disease. And because our water is not, you know, as good as one would have expected, if you come to Freetown, most of you have not been to Freetown for a long time. If you come to Freetown, you see pipes. They call them spaghetti pipes. And they are in gutters where dirty water is just passing over them. So if there's a hole in those spaghetti pipes, if there is visible cholera passing around, like it just goes to the street and somebody ends up drinking that water. Those are some of the things. I mean, when the president decided to have a separate ministry for water, a ministry of water resources, that was a very good move. So what we are doing in our cholera task force meeting is to make sure that the Ministry of Water Resources is represented. Because when we talk about cholera, it's not only the Ministry of Health thing. We have to bring all the players around so that at the end of the day, we are able to stop what has presented the disease.
Okay, thank you. That's a point there. Mr. Hussein Ibrahim, can you make your concluding remarks?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. I really appreciate what the speaker just said. I mean,
standing from the outside, it seems like a lack of political will. And when you talk about laws, yes, a lot of these laws does exist, but it's the enforcement of the laws, the enforcement of the rules. So I'm very happy the last speaker brought this issue up. And also, yes, we need to review them. There's some that are bad or there's some that are unenforceable rules. But there's also the lack of transparency, and let's not forget the corruption in the health system itself. But going forward with this, what we need to look at, we need to look at more the preventive side of medicine. We need to strengthen our primary health care centers. These are the first points of contact. You can have your hospital, that can be the case, and that can then feed down to the health centers itself. We also need to look at reorientation of the training of health workers towards preventive roles that include communication of health promotion, contact to people, and also then we talk about health education. We also need to include, we were just discussing when we were talking about cholera, the environment, we're talking about sanitation. We also need to include that. Personal hygiene, sanitation and environmental health. Nutrition. We talked a lot about nutrition, and I keep telling people there is a lot that we can learn from what we have in Sierra Leone. When my kids suffer from hydration, I don't give them ORS. Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, I give them enough water. Mm-hmm. So there's a whole lot of other things that we can look at. We have in Sierra Leone that can take the burden of importing our Western drugs. And this is why sometimes as well we need to engage with traditional healers. Because don't forget, we live in a pluralism society. People workers have to compete with traditional healers. And we need to bridge this difference between traditional practitioner and Western medical practitioners. And primary healthcare personnel must understand this behavior. And what we're trying to do, our Western trained health workers, is to compete rather than engage with traditional health workers. Traditional practitioners.
Yeah, I think the government, well, I'm not sure if they have a policy on complementary and alternative medicine, as they call it, you know, I don't know. But it's a brilliant point. To just stay on this topic for a while, Mr. Mambu, can you make your concluding remarks regarding this, that we have this one?
Thank you very much. I listened to the preventive aspect from Dr. Dafoa, and he was talking about the law. One of the issues that is confronting Sierra Leone is lawlessness. You know, we have been a state where the set of the law rules the people is the people that rules the law. And in that case, they take the laws into their own hands. You know, a lot of the issues that are responsible for the declining of the health and the sanitation which allows cholera and diarrhea are issues that are stated in a lot of our law books, preventive law books, mechanisms have been put in place, but they are definitely not enforced. For instance, I tell you, if you come to our cities, especially in Africa, people have built houses in the cholera-prone areas, in disaster areas, and the government have not had the ability, you know, and the way to remove those people in those areas. Almost every yell of stone falling on people, you know, people building on waterways, you know, destroying the forest, even around the Guma Valley area. All of them have been illegally taken up, you know, by people, and they are constructing houses, dwelling housing, and where people do not also have toilet, proper toilet facility, you know. So the measures are actually taken, you know. So as a result of that, people are taking the laws into their own hands, including a detriment to their own life, or the health situation, the environmental situations within the community and within the cities becoming very, very problem today. So that's the issue. It's not that the laws are not there. The laws are there, but they are definitely not enforced. And in an event where they are sometimes effectively enforced. Some people will be removed, you know, from one place where others will also be asked to remain in that particular place, even at the detriment of the city, at the detriment of the people themselves, and at the detriment of the nation. So these are some of the issues that we are actually facing, which are contributing factor to the continuous spread of diarrhea and cholera in the country. Where some of these factors are actually eradicated with proper and political willingness by government to take, you know, the bull by the horn, it will become a proper mechanism to ensure proper public care. Let me give you an example. Earlier this year, the government, through His Excellency the President, launched an operation which they call Operation Weed, which was actually geared towards making the city very, very clean by removing traders from the street, by removing garages, removing all of the 50 areas in the city. After some time, that operation died down. You know, people came back on the street, you know, continue constructing electric houses along the street of Freetown in areas where they have originally they removed waterways were again obstructed, which allowed water to spread along the street of Freetown and a lot of other communities. You know, these are some of the things that we are saying. We must have the political way to implement measures irrespective of who is going to gain and who is going to benefit, as long as the benefit for the nature is greater than that of the benefit for an individual or group of individuals.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mambu. And,
I just say something quickly, please?
Yes, just quickly. Yes,
yeah, just for 30 seconds. I know we're talking about cholera because there was an outbreak, but let's not forget there's a huge incident of typhus, hepatitis, and HIV in Sierra Leone as well.
Yes, these are some of the issues we'll be handling in our second and third issues, I mean, because we'll be having a second and a third installment on health system. This is just the first. We'll come back, we'll try to address some of these issues, you know, that we have on social. This is just an introduction. But, I mean, you've done brilliantly. I must commend you. I must thank you to Dr. Daphne. Thank you to Mr. Ibrahim and thank you to Mr. Mambu. We just want you to say goodbye to the audience now. Dr. Daphne, can you say goodbye to the audience?
Okay, goodbye, listeners, and thanks for listening to us.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Mambu?
Yeah, as I said goodbye, I want to thank you very much, the organizer and call on our brothers and sisters in the Diaspora, to come back to Sierra Leone to join us to rebuild the country, bring more investment into our country. It's good that we talk about these issues using international media, but we are also calling on all of you to do whatever you could in your own little way to come and support the people of Sierra Leone in our quest to rebuild a better country.
Thank you for the invitation. Mr. Ibrahim?
Thank you very much for having me and for the listeners. Remember, prevention is better than cure. Look after your personal hygiene. Use best practices like rest, exercise, nutrition. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you, listeners. Abdul Mahdi Savage. Thank you.
You are listening to Voices from the Diaspora.